On a day 35 years ago, a collection of atoms and particles combined into a discrete, complex structure that, somehow, was more than the sum of its parts. The elements involved were mainly oxygen, 65% of the total mass to be exact, but the structure also included 18.5% carbon, 9.5% hydrogen, 3.5% nitrogen, and a touch of calcium and phosphorus. These elements combine in our universe all the time. But what was surprising about this particular structure is that it got up one day and identified itself with the name Alex McColgan. It was me. The same thing happened to the elements that made up you and everyone that you know, and the elements that comprise everyone that has ever lived, which, when you think about it, is decidedly odd. How does what is essentially a pile of rocks, air, water, and chemicals have a sense of identity? And yet, somehow, that is what happened. Consciousness arose from dust and seemingly keeps arising. Which begs the question, where exactly did consciousness come into this equation? At the end, with a fully developed human brain, with an animal brain, a plant, a single bacteria? Or can we make the claim that if matter can be conscious, a single atom of matter is conscious too? I'm Alex McColgan, and you're watching Astrum. Join me down the rabbit hole today as we enter the wonderland that is consciousness, our best theories on how it arises, and as we attempt to answer one simple question: can a particle be conscious? To begin with, I'll acknowledge that on the surface that seems like a facetious question. Most people have a fairly good gut instinct about what is conscious and what isn't. You are conscious. After all, you have a sense of identity. You make choices, and you consider the information your senses bring you, and you ascribe value to what you experience. To paraphrase a famous philosopher called René Descartes, we cannot doubt our own consciousness, because otherwise, who would be doing the doubting? We think, therefore we are. Beyond that, we are usually quite confident of the consciousness of the fellow humans around us. Although we cannot see inside their heads, we can usually ascribe to them the same capacity for thought and experience that we enjoy, except, of course, when they're on the other side of the political spectrum to us. But our instincts start to get a little more hesitant after that. Researchers into animal behavior were asked in a survey whether they believed the animals they were studying were conscious. While 92% of the respondents were happy to say non-human primates were conscious, only 73% extended this attribute to other mammals. For octopuses, it dropped to 64%, birds 61%, and for insects, only 51% of the sampled researchers believe them to have an intrinsic sense of self. It's likely that the general population feel a similar way. However, here we have already strayed into the big problem of consciousness, belief and feelings. The above survey was based on the gut instinct of those surveyed, as conscious experience is very difficult to prove. Just consider the debate surrounding whether artificial intelligence counts as consciousness, when it can mimic humans quite convincingly. Is a recorded message conscious? A written note? All this is hardly a solid foundation for good science. We need something a little more precise and measurable if we are to answer whether matter itself can possess consciousness. Which is unfortunate, as no such test currently exists. In fact, there is very little consensus among philosophers and cognitive scientists as to what consciousness, or qualia, instances of subjective, conscious experience as they call it, actually even is. There are plenty of theories as to how we get it. Global neural workspace theory notes that particular parts of the brain light up when we think about certain things. It attaches consciousness to these areas, the parts of the brain doing front of the brain thinking. It points out that we can only perceive one thing at a time in the stage of our mind. For instance, have you seen the optical illusion of the vase and the face? If you look at this image, you might see a vase, or you might see a face, but your mind flicks between the two interpretations without trying to see both simultaneously. Consciousness is a stage, and only so many things can have prominence there at once. However, another prominent theory called integrated information theory takes a different tact. It claims that consciousness is a product of information, and thus consciousness is not formed in the parts of the brain that do the thinking per se, but rather in the parts of the brain that do the perceiving. A large enough pool of information that can influence itself will always be conscious, according to this theory. An interesting case study that supports this idea is what happens to you when you're asleep or unconscious. Now, you might consider consciousness to be your ability to perceive events, evaluate them, form opinions on them, and then make decisions as to what to do about them. But even when we are asleep, when we are unconscious, this ability doesn't completely go away. For instance, what happens when you tickle the nose of a sleeping person? After a few moments of tickling, they might move to swat your hand away, or at least move their face to avoid it, which means that some part of their brain, despite being unconscious, still evaluated information, assigned value to it, like I don't like having my nose tickled, and made and carried out a decision to do something about it. It might lack the conscious experience, but something in the brain was clearly aware of what was going on. Can you be said to possess consciousness even in this scenario? This is not the only instance of our brains doing thinking quietly, behind the curtain, so to speak. Some people with sight impairment have been found to possess something known as blind sight. They are blind, they have no conscious awareness of sight or anything around them. And yet, the neural pathways in their brain that carry visual information are still intact. As a result, patients with blind sight can navigate rooms without bumping into things, in spite of not being able to perceive what is there. Their brain knows where to go, even if they don't. Consciousness is about more than just the higher level thoughts we experience. In spite of all the advances in brain scans that have taken place over the years, it is still no clearer which of these theories about the origins of consciousness are correct, if either of them, because neither really explains the nature of consciousness itself. Yes, they might try to explain where in the brain it happens, but what it actually is? That's still up for debate. Which brings us back to our original question. Can particles be conscious? If there is no consensus amongst the investigators studying this phenomenon, it seems that we need to ask a few questions of our own. Let's try paring down what we mean by the word consciousness. How much thinking needs to occur before we can say that a thing is conscious? We are usually fairly generous in this regard. If we are happy to say that even small infants are conscious, even if the thoughts they might be thinking might be a little more than happy, happy, oh, what's that, sad, then it seems that not many thoughts are acquired before we can call a thing conscious. In fact, if you looked at a rock and could prove with absolute certainty that it thought even a single thought, I believe it's reasonable to say that for a moment, that rock possessed at least a slither of consciousness. Second, let's describe the apparatus of consciousness. As has been alluded to already, consciousness is a product of the brain. You likely have an innate sense of this. Consider your whole body and ask yourself, where are you in that body? Look at your hands, look at your chest, your legs. Those belong to you, and yes, you can control them. But are they where you are? The bit of you that is aware? Unlikely. Most people, when asked about it, would say that their core self exists in the space behind their eyes, i.e. the exact same location as their brain. And this makes sense. Remove the brain, and the body is no longer alive. cease all brain activity, and the sense of self vanishes entirely. Conscious experience is connected to brain activity. And what exactly is brain activity? Electrical impulses moving through neurons. Anytime we think, neurons are lighting up. We might not be able to explain exactly why this leads to human consciousness, but that is what the evidence indicates is happening. So how many neurons are required before we can say we are thinking a thought? A billion? A million? Just one? That seems to be down to your own personal viewpoint. What threshold of activity is necessary before you're willing to say a thing is conscious? Is there a line something must cross? Or is it a scale where anything above zero is good enough? You, yourself, will have varying levels of brain activity between sleep and wakefulness. Are you conscious and unconscious? Or do you possess a certain level of consciousness all along? Perhaps the answer really is that consciousness is a spectrum, just as the IIT theorists would have it. And if we are willing to agree that only a single thought, or even a single firing neuron is necessary before we can agree to a thing being conscious, albeit barely, then it becomes possible to conclude consciousness must be present in almost everything that exists, anything carrying electrical impulses. That may well include things that don't have brains at all. And how much further down does this go? If we claim that a single neuron firing represents an infinitesimal speck of consciousness because of the chemical and electrical processes going on within it, does that mean we can go even more fundamental with consciousness? A neuron fires when electrical charge changes, causing an action potential to fire, sending an electrical signal down the axon. If that electrical signal is the source of consciousness, does that mean consciousness exists because of the electrons and the ions themselves? Are other things with electrons moving also slightly conscious? Wiring carrying electricity? Atoms chemically reacting with each other, exchanging electrons and altering their charge? Or do we go even deeper again, down to the quantum level? We know that particles exist in a state of superposition. Until something happens that collapses the waveform and a particle is forced to decide if it's here or there. Is it actually deciding at that moment, employing a tiny level of consciousness? I don't know. This is pure speculation at this point, as science has no universally agreed upon idea of what causes waveform collapse. All that we know is that it happens, and oddly enough, it happens somewhere between the start of the waveform's propagation and when something consciously becomes aware of that waveform in a way that measures it. Do with that information as you wish. Consciousness down on the scale of particles themselves is certainly strange to consider. But there are some heavy-hitting physicists today who are open to quantum effects playing an important role in consciousness, including Nobel Prize winner Roger Penrose. There's even an official term for it, panpsychism. The concept that everything contains at least a tiny bit of consciousness, which is how consciousness can arise from matter in the first place. And what are you other than organized particles you've consumed throughout your lifetime? It seems counter to common sense, but then so do a lot of the universe's laws. Strange or not, it has advantages over the alternative, which I find a little worrying. When we say that some kind of threshold is necessary before we are willing to say that a thing is conscious, there's a lot of room to be arbitrary in where exactly we put those goalposts. We might say, everything with a brain is conscious, animals and humans. We might say, all humans are conscious, and all animals are not. But worryingly, a smarter human with more brain power and more firing neurons might decide that every human with fewer firing neurons than him doesn't pass the consciousness test. Or maybe one day we'll discover an alien life form and find ourselves in the disturbing position where no human is smart enough or possessing the correct threshold of electrical activity in their brain to be considered conscious, by an alien's definition. Can a particle be conscious? Certainly, I don't believe that atoms are bumping around, thinking to themselves that electrons just aren't the same as they were back in the good old days, or that protons feel neutrons are a little bit bland. But if all our consciousness derives these fundamental elements of physics, and we have not yet found some extra ingredient beyond that, then is the idea that particles are conscious really that far-fetched? At least a tiny bit? Naturally, it would be impossible to measure. But in that respect, particles are in good company. It's currently scientifically impossible to prove that anything or anyone in the entire universe is conscious at all, with only one exception: you. Scientifically, you can't prove consciousness in anyone else. So, how many people do you want to include in the club? What are your thoughts about consciousness? Are all particles conscious? If not, what is consciousness and where does it come from? If you like this topic, there's a similar one I would like to do on a video about free will. We didn't really get into that in this script, but it's a fascinating topic. Let me know in the comments below if that's something you'd like to see. Thanks for watching. Making this video required some long-term planning and work, which we were only able to do thanks to the consistency and sustainability of your memberships as Astronauts on Patreon. A huge thank you to everyone who has signed up. And if you'd like us to make more videos like this, you can join with the link down below. When you join, you'll be able to watch the whole video ad-free, see your name in the credits, and submit questions to our team. Once again, a huge thank you from myself and the whole Astrum team. Meanwhile, click the link to this playlist for more Astrum content. I'll see you next time.